Worries of a Winter Walk. An excerpt from Literature and Life, Short Stories and Essays, written by William Dean Howells. Narrated by Michael Scott. Produced by ThoughtAudio.com. The other winter, as I was taking a morning walk down to the East River, I came upon a bit of our motley life, a fact of our piebald civilization, which has perplexed me from time to time ever since, and which I wish now to leave with the reader for his or her more thoughtful consideration. Chapter 1. The morning was extremely cold. It professed to be sunny, and there was really some sort of hard glitter in the air, which, so far from being tempered by this effulgence, seemed all the stonier for it. Blasts of frigid wind swept the streets and buffeted each other in a fury of resentment when they met around the corners. Although I was passing through a populous tenement house quarter, my way was not hindered by the sports of the tenement house children, who commonly crowd one from the sidewalks. No frozy head looked out over the fire escapes. There were no peddlers' carts or voices in the roadway. Not above, three or four shawl-hooded women cowered out of the little shops with small purchases in their hands. Not so many tiny girls with jugs opened the doors of the beer saloons. The butcher's windows were painted with patterns of frost, through which I could dimly see the frozen meats hanging like hideous stalactites from the roof. When I came to the river, I ached in sympathy with the shipping painfully atilt on the rock-like surface of the brine, which broke against the piers and sprayed itself over them like showers of powdered quartz. But it was before I reached this final point that I received into my consciousness the moments of the human comedy which have been an increasing burden to it. Within a block of the river, I met a child so small that at first I almost refused to take my account of her, until she appealed to my sense of humor by her amusing disproportion to the pail which she was lugging in front of her with both of her little mittened hands. I am scrupulous about mittens, though I was tempted to write of her little naked hands, red with the pitiless cold. This would have been more effective, but it would not have been true. And the truth obliges me to own that she had a stout, warm-looking knit jacket on. The pail, which was half her height and twice her bulk, was filled to overflowing with small pieces of coal and coke. And if it had not been for this, I might have taken her for a child of the better classes. She was so comfortably clad. But in that case, she would have had to be 15 or 16 years old in order to be doing so efficiently and responsibly the work which, as the child of the worst classes, she was actually doing at 5 or 6. We must indeed allow that the early self-helplessness of such children is very remarkable, and all the more so because they grow up into men and women so stupid that, according to the theories of all polite economists, they have to have their discontent with their conditions put into their heads by malevolent agitators.